Welcome to the second face-to-face session on workplace communication. I would straight away go to some centers just to check in that if we are working on minutes, how many people are there on time? Should we go to the remote centers? I'm sure you all must have had a wonderful lunch.
Hello. Very good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon and welcome back.
I have a question, ma'am, about an interview.
About interview?
Yes, ma'am.
Which was in the first session, in the soft skill session. Okay, go ahead.
How a person increase their confidence level?
How will a person improve on their confidence level is the question which one of the remote centers have asked. We have moved into workplace communication. And because his question is pertinent to workplace communication, let's take it. So in order to improve your confidence level, you have to start working on it. If it is interview, if it is a project, if it is a presentation, it could be anything, any form of communication. But if you want to come across as a confident person, you need to work on your knowledge base and you need to work on your communication skills. And some of the barriers to communication are psychological barriers. It is fear to fail. So let's face it, unless and until we target that fear, we cannot move ahead in any form of communication. It could be interviews, it could be presentations, it could be written communication. Even before sending an email perhaps or a letter, writing a brief, a note, perhaps you would wonder many a times, what should I write, what should I write? So unless and until you have worked on your knowledge quotient and your communication skills, that psychological barrier has been taken care of, we cannot move ahead. And in order to take care of the psychological barrier, friends, it is important that we concentrate on how we are interacting with people. We need to have our friends, our peer group around us who could tell us that this is the place where you can improve. This is the place where you actually have gained mastery. This is something which is your strength, and you must work on it when you are there for a presentation or an interview. So it is a psychological barrier which you have to pass, a psychological threshold. And for that, start working now. Start working in groups. Start doing mirror practices. What you could do, you could just take up an interview topic. You can just take a question, prepare an answer to it, and rehearse it before a mirror. When you're making that presentation, rehearse before a mirror. Record it just to find out how you sound when you are making the presentation. So is that okay? Sardar Patel Institute of Technology. Hello.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon.
It seems you all have had a good lunch.
Yeah, sure.
Yes. So are you ready to post questions to us?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. Go ahead.
I am coordinator from Sardar Patel Institute of Technology.
Lovely.
I'll hand over mic to my students so that they will ask a question to you.
Okay. Thank you.
Hello, ma'am.
Hello.
Good afternoon, ma'am. My name is Saurabh Thakur. I want to ask something. If interview were asked about, tell me about yourself something. So how can I approach that question?
You know, on my frame, I have 6 of you here. Tell me how many of you have seen the videos that were sent to you? Did you go through the video?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes? Okay, lovely. Then I'm happy to answer your question. Did you all go through the video? Honest answers. Yes or no?
Yes, sir. Yes,
how many of you went through those videos? Please put your hands up. Honest answer. I love that integrity. Some who did not go through it did not raise their hand, and I really appreciate this integrity. But I would want you all, we are working very hard and we are really enjoying our job interacting with you all. So please go through those videos. They would definitely help you out. As far as tell me something about yourself is concerned, I had mentioned earlier also in my previous soft skill communication that you need to prepare for it. Prepare an answer because you know it is going to come. Prepare an answer. Do not memorize it, but rehearse it, record it. And I said what you could do is you could start with where you were born, your birthplace, perhaps, because even if I tell you that does not matter, you would definitely bring it in as a fresher. Then you could move on to academics. Then you could move on to what you love doing and how you see yourself exploring the avenues with that particular firm. So this is what your introduction should be. It should be crisp and it should be prepared, although you should appear conversational over there. Okay, please go through the recordings because I had elaborated on this question in the previous session. Thank you. Is any question on workplace communication? I'll be happy to answer.
Thank you, ma'am.
Pleasure, dear. Any other query?
No, ma'am. Thank you.
Perumal College.
Good afternoon, ma'am. I have a question.
Yeah.
How to communicate multicultural surroundings?
Lovely. Very good. You know, we are moving in a global atmosphere with technological advancement. It is technology that has brought us together. You and me interacting like this is technology. And this technology takes a global manifestation. So when we talk about globalization, we must bring in and we must be mindful of the cross-cultural communication. My first suggestion is that when you are traveling, when you are in a different cultural zone, your first action should be to be watchful. Try to assimilate the culture. Try to see understand the culture of the people for a couple of days. And if you're not staying there for a couple of days, if you're staying there perhaps for 5 or 6 hours and yet you have to interact with those people as it happens in meetings and all, be absolutely professional and be watchful of your gestures. Because the gestures have different implications in different culture. So before using, it is much better to understand them. Normally we use this signal as, okay, it's good. This is used as thumbs up. But all these may have a different connotation if you're traveling to some Latin American countries. So here I would say that be mindful of what your gestures, and before talking, just be a little careful about what your intonation is, how you are speaking with them. Is the culture like in an American culture, if you're working for an American multinational over there, they are pretty casual about things, although their written documentation is perfect, but the work atmosphere perhaps would be a little casual. It would be on a first name basis, but if you're working for a British company, there the work culture would be different. In Japan, the work culture is more relaxed. We call them high context culture simply because they wish to have long-term relationships with you and therefore they would talk about families also. So we need to be very careful about these things. Would you like to add on to the question, dear?
How to overcome the physical barrier?
Okay, the question raised by one of the centers is how to overcome physical barriers. So what are physical barriers? What do you understand by physical barrier?
Ma'am, when we are communicating with the people, the surroundings may be imbalanced for us, right?
Very good. So let us suppose that there are 3 chairs taken. We have to communicate for the next 4 to 5 hours, okay? And suddenly there is some issue with the air conditioner. Fine. We are trying to reach you out and there is noise disruption. So all these would be physical barriers, okay?
Ma'am, there's one more question here.
Okay.
Ma'am, how to overcome nervousness during interview?
I think most of the participants here have attended the soft skills portion also, and they are coming back to interview skills and group discussion questions. Friends, we have started on workplace communication, but yes, that is a continuation. And so I will take this. I would appreciate if the questions pertain to workplace communication. But then how to hold your nervousness? Tell me, students, what makes you nervous before an interview? The fear of failure. I have spoken about these things in the previous session. So if the students have not attended the previous session, they may please go back to the slides and look for these answers. For the time being, what makes you feel nervous is the fear of failure. First and foremost, we need to combat that. We need to prepare answers to the standard questions and we need to rehearse it, mirror practice it. We need to practice mock interviews and record them so that we actually get a feeling of how we are doing in an interview. And this should be done at a professional level. It shouldn't be a mere practice session. You should get into the mock interview mode with a professional tone. Okay? We'll take another center, I guess. We are Sagar Institute, Bhopal. Welcome back.
Good afternoon, ma'am. Name is Sujit Kumar. My question is, what are the challenges in workplace communication? How can we become perfect in this area?
Sujit, may I request your understanding of workplace communication first? What is workplace communication? And if we are talking about challenges, there could be several, but what particularly are you looking at? One of the centers, Sujit from one of the centers, has just asked us, what are the challenges at workplace communication? Go ahead.
Yeah, I think in workplace communication, we face challenges. We have different kinds of people. We have to interact with different attitudes and different languages. We have to face them. So we have to understand their problems and what are their solutions.
You know what? The answer is embedded in the question or the statement you just made. You said we work with people from different background and they have different attitude. So in workplace communication, obviously we would have people from all over the place. And it is the perfect example of a team evolving and doing extremely well because they bring in different observation. They bring in freshness, and therefore it is very important to try and help emerge a team out of it. You know, we talk about here, again, we could go to one particular aspect. It is like you form a group, then you norm, then you negotiate within the group, then certain explanations and expressions emerges from the group, and now you finalize it and you work towards the results. All these would involve an understanding of cross-culture communication. When you see a people and a particular behavior, do not judge them immediately. So let us suppose, for example, if I may say, I hail from Bihar, but I have lived most of my life in Delhi, some of my life in UP, and now I have been in Mumbai for a long time. So I have seen all these places. So I find that in Bihar, normally people would not speak much, especially for the interviews. But once they are geared in, they are zoned in, they would start formulating answers. Delhi again, we have people who really might become leaders. Bombay is very professional. So when we meet people from all these areas, they are going to add to the group. How would you deal with people who is euphoric? Do not deal with the people, I would say. Deal with the issue. How would you adapt to the people? You don't have to adapt to the people. You have to take care of the of what he brings on the table. So if somebody has a loud tone of voice, for a moment, negate it. See what he has brought on the table. And later, perhaps he would watch you all talking at a softer tone and he would understand which tone is suitable for workplace communication. Now, if somebody is very loud and he needs to be told that you are loud, this should happen within closed doors. Over there, you could let the person know that perhaps this is the reason why people find it difficult to communicate with him. So adaptability comes with understanding, with patience, and with giving the people around you the margin to explore and explain themselves. Does that help?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon, dear.
Ma'am, we are very glad to that we can interact with you.
Lovely.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for this opportunity. Ma'am, I want to ask one question. Ma'am, how should body language is the most important thing. When we enter the room, they start observing us. So how should we enter and how should we sit there and how should we go? Because they observe us till we move from their room.
Okay.
Ma'am, over to you.
Okay, dear. Rehearse this before coming for the interview. Once you've dressed up in your room, just walk to the mirror, see what your profile looks like, okay? And whichever profile suits you, try to emulate that particular profile when you are entering. Post entering, wait for them for say 5 seconds to 10 seconds to ask you to make yourself comfortable. It could be the case that they have been looking at the resume or certain other things and have forgotten to tell you to make yourself comfortable. So if it is post 10 to 15, 10 seconds, ask them, may I? And then you can sit down, okay? Wish them, if it is good morning, wish them good morning. If it is good afternoon, wish them good afternoon. And take your seat. They would definitely tell you, make yourself comfortable. So please make yourself comfortable. Do not sit on the edge of the chair. If you have seen my videos, you would have seen the body language that I don't sit on the, over there we've shown that don't sit on the edge of the chair, because if you sit on the edge of the chair, the entire body is aligned so that you would feel thirsty after some time if the interview progresses for a longer time. Okay, so that is how we need to tackle that.
Ma'am, one another question I wanted to ask. Ma'am, if they are asking, if you would lie for company, then what should be the best answer?
If I can lie for this company, I can be lying right now. Okay? If I can lie for your company, so yes, that will be the answer. Okay? If I can lie for your company, I could be lying right now. I would rather negotiate around my clients. I would rather negotiate and try to modify their opinion than to lie straight away. Okay?
Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Pleasure, dear. Does that work for you?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, dear. Over to you.
A very good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon.
Ma'am, my name is Sanjay Trivath from second year mechanical branch.
Oh, mechanical. Yes, sir.
And my question is, ma'am, how can I answer the question like, where do you see yourself in next 5 years?
Okay. Because we are having so many questions from the interview skills, let me just tell you one thing. Interview skills, you cannot ace it then and there. You have to prepare for it. So let us suppose you are going for Reliance or you are going for one of the major companies. You need to know what the company structure is. You must, if you really wish to work for that company, you should have found out about the hierarchy. What you could do within 5 years. What best you can achieve within 5 years. If they ask you, where do you see yourself in the next 5 years? Then you could answer if you have gone through the company's history, if you have gone through the company's hierarchy, if you have read the vision and the mission of the company, perhaps you'd be able to answer that question. Apart from that, 5 years is too short a time. So let us suppose if you are caught in the net and you have not done it, you could say, I see myself at a managerial position as well as student, because I know 5 years is too short a time to master everything. I would still be learning and yet would try to impart my learning to my junior colleagues. So therefore, I think I would be looking at a managerial position. Okay?
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, one more question. What are your expectations from our side about what you want?
What are your expectations from the company?
Yes, ma'am.
So as a fresher, the question is, what are your expectations? We are still at the interview level. And the question is, what are your expectations from our company? So you are a fresher. You are a second year student. You still have 3 years, 2 years to go. So as a fresher, your expectation would be that you should be given the opportunity to learn. You should be given the opportunity to work with teams and increase your learnings, your aptitude, and be able to work and get adapted to the attitude which works in that company. Okay? At that level, as a fresher, learning is more important. So if it is a consultancy firm, you should be able to get active participation in the company. Okay?
Yes, ma'am. And one more question is that.
Okay.
How long you expect to work at our company if you get hired?
For this, how long do you intend to work as a fresher? You have asked this question as a fresher. You could just say, sir, it surely depends on how I perform for the company and what I gain from the company. So it is a mutual thing. If I am able to get a role wherein I feel I have been learning all through, I would definitely like to stick to it. And I'm sure you would also, if MBA is a necessity in the company, I'm sure you would also want me to go ahead and do an MBA, right? So this is how you could navigate around that question. Now, many a times what happens, you want to do an MBA. Post 2 years of experience, you would want to go do an MBA. Many of the companies, they have a tie-up with the MBA institutes, ISB. So over there, perhaps you could use this to let them know that you are interested in doing your MBA through them, sticking around. Fine?
Yes,
so
ma'am.
It is a call which you have to take.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. We'll move on to someone else.
Thank you, ma'am.
Some other center. Thank you very much. Friends, any center which has questions on workplace communication, centered around workplace communication. Center 1193.
Good afternoon. Students want to interact with you.
Thank you so much. Please go ahead.
This is Abhilash, RC 1193. My yes. question is there. Is there essential to opt certification to present our capabilities? Can interior may not believe on my sale, which I told them.
Well, normally we carry a thick folder when we go for these interviews. We are very proud of our achievements and we love to showcase them. I appreciate that gesture. Please carry those capabilities. Please carry those certificates. But always remember, the interviewer doesn't have the chance, the time to go through all the certifications. So if you have a national level or a state level certification in anything, it is then that they would look onto it. Okay? So carry those certifications That is fine.
Very good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon.
Myself, Rajesh.
Go ahead.
Ma'am, I have a question about the previous section about GD.
Mm-hmm.
Ma'am, in a GD group discussion, suppose I'm asking about higher level, not for interviewing. If I am selected in a company and suppose I am a leader, right, and I have 3 or 5 members team,
right,
but they are not paying their 100% in the work, or they are not not participating fully, their full potential. Okay, so how to convince them to give their 100%?
The scenario is of a GD, right? The question just asked just now is again on GD. It pertains to the previous session. Rajesh says that it is not for the selection process, but in a corporate, if people are not giving their 100% in the group interview, in the group discussions, how should we motivate them? Now, since it is a group discussion which is going on, we could follow the Apple technique. I had mentioned this technique previously also. The leader may ask question. He may ask question in such loose-ended questions, and he may ask for participation. He could probe that question a little further, and then he can ask people to answer on them. He should, by his body language, try to show that he's listening. And once he has listened to that person, he should explain, expand, explore the particular assessment that has been made. Now, what happens when we try this Apple technique? The person with whom we have engaged in a communication in the GD, he feels a little warm about himself, as though he has made a contribution. It may not be much worth. It may not be of much worth. But what happens, it gives him a sense of satisfaction. So perhaps if you suggest something different, he would now start participating. So this is how you need to motivate. And once you are in a corporate setup, I think the best motivation comes when you tell them that, listen, we are in a GD. We have to brainstorm. We have to talk about certain things. And being in a GD costs money. Since it costs money, let us do something about it, because we may have to send perhaps some document, some report on it. Okay? Friends, do we have any question on workplace communication at this center?
Yes, ma'am.
1174?
Yes, ma'am. A question on workplace communication.
Okay. So let's take that first.
I'm from Turkish Institute of Science and Technology. My name is Fatima Nafisa. India is a land of cultural diversity, as we know. So in a workplace, we have to communicate with people with different type of languages, different cultures, and etc. So how can we do that? How can we communicate effectively? And how can work ethics help in that?
You know, when we go abroad, we gel well with the people there. Do you know why? Because India is a land of cultural diversity. So your question has already been answered, but in a couple of sentences, I would once again reiterate what I said earlier. It is not the person we are questioning. It is not only the person with whom we are interacting at a workplace. At a workplace, it is the issue. It is the project. It is the problem that must take precedence. I may not be very comfortable with the ways of other people, but it is not, I'm not there to be comfortable. I'm there to work. I'm there to act. So if we are not comfortable with people in my group, in my division, we don't need to isolate ourselves. What we need to do is concentrate on the work. Because once you have started concentrating on the work and approaching the people to concentrate on the work as well, you would then realize that a team spirit is gradually evolving. You would come to know interpersonal relationship will then establish. You would understand the uniqueness of that person. You would understand that you could depend for this particular thing, you would depend for that on that particular person. So then what happens, what the culture is, what the religion is, how they act in a particular situation, are they reticent, are they exuberant, these things would not matter. And eventually, when you have started working together, things would settle down and people would come on the same page. So when you face difficulty, concentrate on the issue, on the project that you're working. Okay?
Thank you. My friend have another question. I'll hand over to her.
Okay.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon.
I'm Grishma from again Talk Kitchen Institute. My question is, what is the difference between normal communication and workplace communication?
So if it were a normal communication, if it were not this platform, Grishma has just now asked what is the difference between normal communication and business communication. So let me tell Grishma. So if it were a normal Grishma, I would have said, hey dude, how are you? Did you have lunch? Right? Since it is business communication and we are communicating from the platform of IIT Bombay X, I would say, hi Grishma, did you have lunch today? I just hope you're feeling comfortable in this venue. In business communication, what happens is it could be documented as this entire thing is being recorded. If I say something which could have a different manifestation, perhaps I shall have to pay for it later. So what I say, what I talk is being documented, is being recorded, and that is why we need to be a little careful when we are communicating at the business space. Even our body language, it has to be monitored. It is being monitored. So if I'm very rude, if you're rude to somebody, that does not go well with the HR department. We may be very good friends, but if the HR department sees us being rude, perhaps they would ask us, why? That is the difference between, I do not say, not for once would I say that you should be rude in your normal conversation or communication, or rudeness is a form of normal communication. No. But there are these norms which you have to follow. You have to be clear when you are communicating. You have to be concise when you are communicating. One written word here and there may create an issue. You have to be courteous always when you are in communication at workplace. You have to be respectful, courteous. So all these things would matter in workplace community. You must have heard of 7 C's of communication or the ABC's of communication. All these ABC's of communication and the 7 C's of communication play a vital role at workplace communication.
And thank you.
Hello, 1269. Good afternoon.
Can I clarify any instruction given to me by my boss? Would it sound ferocious?
Okay. The question which has just been asked is, can I clarify the instruction given from my boss? Obviously, if you have not understood it, you have to clarify it. Now, your worry would be that if I go back and ask my boss to clarify it, perhaps this will not go down well with him. So what you could do is you could paraphrase it, or you could parrot it. You could just go and tell your boss that, is this what I am supposed to do? Take the risk. You may have misunderstood, you may have understood, but it is pertinent that you go and clarify, simply because if you do not clarify, you'll not be able to work properly in that stream. Okay? So take that risk, go and speak to the boss and seek clarification. Center 1015, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, ma'am. Ma'am, if I'm a freshman in a company, I'm not getting the freedom to work. So what should I be doing? For example, should I go to the manager? Would he feel like I'm more complaining? Or should I be saying nothing? And saying nothing would frustrate me. So what should I be doing?
The question asked just now is, if I feel that I'm not getting the space to work, the freedom to work in a company as a fresher, what should I do? Go and speak with your boss. As a fresher, you have a lot of energy and you wish to do things pretty soon, pretty fast. While the company would want you to take things at its pace, because while you think that you are learning, you may still not have adapted to the ways of the company, not assimilated the culture of the company. That is one part. But if you feel that you're doing well in that part, and yet you are not being recognized, or you are sitting idle and that is frustrating you, what you could do is send an email to your boss and request him for 5 minutes of his time. When you get the appointment, go to him and you should have prepared a list of what you wish to do, what you could do, where you could contribute. Okay? Merely saying that I'm not getting my space does not work at workplace communication, does not work at workplace. You need to tell them where you can put in more efforts. So go there, find it out. Tell him that you have been assigned this work, you have been completing this work, you do not have any other work, or you would be more interested in doing this work. So now the manager would know that he has somebody who needs to work in this area and he wants more work. He wants more space, more freedom to work. Okay? So perhaps he would bear that in mind, and when the time comes, he would watch you And if he sees that you are mature enough to handle certain situations, he would give it. So I personally feel that if it is in your heart, you must seek an appointment and then go and talk about it, rather than getting frustrated and looking for a job elsewhere if the company is very good. Okay?
It'd be more complaining if I go to him.
So that is why what I said, I asked you to write an email first. So seek an appointment and then prepare a list and tell him, sir, I would like to do it in this. Is it possible? Not I would like to. Is it possible that we approach this particular issue in this manner?
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Okay. Let's move on to another center. Center 1261.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon.
Yes, ma'am. My name is Hitesh More from Meds Institute of Engineering. Ma'am, I have two questions regarding first session. With what exact attitude we should enter the office for an interview?
Enter the office for an interview.
Go for the interview.
The question raised just now is with what attitude we should go for an interview. I would ask you with what attitude you would want to go to an interview. It has to be a positive attitude. You know, you may be dying to be a part of that company, but before you really go for that interview, that aspiration should be there, but it should not be obsessive, because the moment it becomes obsessive, it comes into your walls. The desperation should come towards the later part of the interview when you have already answered the questions well. Then if you show the desperation to be a part of the company, it works well for you. But in the beginning, you should go with a positive attitude, a confident attitude, and yet it should be, let's take life in its stride. You have already prepared the answers to the most common question. So now if there is a trick question out there, see how you would figure around that, how you would handle that, because your interview would rest on how you answer the tricky questions. Okay? So go with a positive attitude always. Any other questions from the workplace community?
The question is, what are the exact things we should do and not do to impress the interviewer on the first place?
Did you go through my slides on interview skills? How many of you sitting here went through the videos that have been uploaded? Please put your hands up. How many of you went through the slides which have been uploaded? I do appreciate your honesty, but students,
yes, ma'am.
If you had gone through those slides, they would have really helped you. This is, I could say, a clarion call to all the students who are participating in this project. You have enrolled for this project and we are working really hard, enjoying the work. We are trying to give the best shot for you all. So it is important that whatever course is uploaded, whatever videos and the quizzes are being uploaded, you go through them, you finish them, and then come for the face-to-face interaction. Because if you have, had you gone through those, perhaps the questions, these questions have already been answered over there. So you could have then come with something new, something creative, something which you have faced. This is, the face-to-face interaction is a reinforcement platform. And we expect every student to go through the videos and then come for it. You'd learn a lot if you go through the videos that have been uploaded on group discussions and interview skills. Please go through them, everyone, and answer the quizzes that have been uploaded. Thank you. Center 1318, good afternoon. Please go ahead with your query.
Sometimes while we are working in an organization, there might be some informal communication going on in the organization itself, which is used by the administrators to know about the policies they should be making. We can choose which informal communications to be part of or which not.
I think you have gone through the videos because you are mentioning the grapevine communication, okay, which is that informal communication within the workplace communication. So what happens here in grapevine communication, that was a communication which normally the employee would have amongst themselves. But now it is being used by the employer also, by the companies also, to let them know whether a particular policy would work with the employee or not. Well, if you see that there could be any organizational issues, if you go ahead with the communication over there, then perhaps you may not participate. But otherwise, in order to maintain the decorum of the, since they have already filtered it through, in order to know your stand on that particular policy, you may participate it, but all but a little carefully. Let it not be a vociferous communication. Just be a little watchful, but you should participate in it and present your viewpoint.
I had another query. Sometimes when we communicate through writing, that is written communication, is it good or is it absolutely bad to add a bit of sarcasm to it?
Sarcasm?
Just a little bit of sarcasm to it.
Students, it would depend on, honestly, I wouldn't use sarcasm in documented stuff. Any documented stuff can be used for legal purposes. And therefore, I would rather advise that do not use any sarcasm. Now, it also depends on what kind of sarcasm have you used over there. You know, is it hurting? Is it directly related to the personality? Does it have an ethnic bias? Does it have a gender bias? Because sarcasm on these issues will be taken very strongly. However, humor is something which you can use in communication, which is internal communication, which is not external communication. Okay? If you really wish to be sarcastic, what is your name?
Punish Sharma.
Okay, Mr. Sharma. If you really wish to be sarcastic, pick the phone up and be sarcastic to the person. Okay?
A very good afternoon, ma'am. I'm Nikhil Thakur. I'm a biomedical engineering student.
Lovely.
I have a question. It's regarding a business. See, this time I am being an employer, mm-hmm. not an employee. So imagine like there's a situation, you're employing someone who's far more senior to you, like maybe a 20-25 years old guy sitting right next to you, and you want to employ him. And you are at my age, like I am being like after graduation or whatever it is, like 26, 27 years old. So what kind of like, you know, what kind of question should I ask? And he should not also feel like he's working with an amateur or some really inferior to him. Like, because the guy next to me is like, just like to my father. And it's like really hard for me to give orders to a guy somewhere up with that age. What should be the, you know, the borders between us?
I think a few minutes back, somebody had asked the question, what is the difference between normal communication and workplace communication? This is the difference between normal communication and workplace communication. Right now, somebody has asked a question that if I am the entrepreneur and I have to hire people who are very senior to me in age, what should be the border? How should I hire them? Students, as I say, workplace communication, post those 8 hours or 12 hours of work, you may go and have a wonderful time with the people you work with. But within that boundary, be it the employer or the employee, there has to be work which takes predominance. So when you are framing questions, frame them exactly you want the person to work for. So let us suppose you're hiring for the marketing side or somebody who has expertise in marketing. So you don't have to think about the age. You frame your questions in such a way that the person feels how he would be helpful to the organization. He answers in that manner. Okay?
Okay, so that means like straightforward questions.
Straightforward questions, subject-oriented questions. Okay?
Okay, thank you so much, ma'am. Barrier.
Pleasure, dear. 1230. Oh, wow. Lovely. Good afternoon. Do you have any query?
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon.
This is Sugashni from Vidhi Vikas College of Engineering and Technology, Tamil Nadu. My query is, what are all the gestures and pushes that we want basically avoid in an interview panel, ma'am?
It is very important to gauge your panel and see whether they are the serious kinds. If you feel that they are all very serious kinds, you should keep your eye contact with them seriously, not smile very much. Although I could suggest that you could be yourself. But if you're being yourself and if you are a gregarious person who smiles at every question, who smiles at every statement, they would fire a question saying, what is there to smile? So if it is a serious panel, your body language would be different. If it is a relaxed panel, your body language would be different. But I would say that for any, the basic body language should be, which we call professional. Your eyes should be talking. Your hands should not do much of a talking. The pen should not go tick, 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 as I have mentioned in my slides also. Your gestures should not be overt, and your facial expression should give the impression that you are interested in answering the question and you are listening, you are hanging on to every word that they are saying while framing the questions. So that should be the body posture when you are there for an interview.
I hand over the mic to my friend.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon. Please go ahead.
Well, HR asking me a question. Mm-hmm. Salary are you expecting from?
Oh, salary you are expecting. Okay, so are you a fresher? Now, for this fresher question, you know, money shouldn't be money. HR, if the HR is asking you what kind of a salary you are expecting, students, if you have scaled the interview and you know that you will be called for an HR interview, I would say please speak with your seniors who are already placed there and try to find out what the salary structure is. Okay? Because what happens if you have not done the homework there, you might end up asking a little less, right? And if you ask an exorbitant price, that would again put you in a different league. They may not consider your application. So what you should do is find it out from your seniors what the salary structure is out there, and then perhaps you could ask for a 10% raise. So when you give the figure, if you have to, if you are forced to give the figure, then perhaps a 10% extra or a 20% extra of the figure which has been mentioned to you by the seniors could be what you could aim at. But a better suggestion is, at that time, you could just tell them, something which keeps me with the company and I don't feel frustrated when I get here. Okay? Whatever is the norm in the company is something which I would like to go ahead with. Fine?
Okay.
Thank you. Center 1294, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon. Did you all have a good lunch?
Yes, ma'am, we have it.
And are you all feeling sleepy now?
Not like that, ma'am.
Not like that. Okay, lovely then, lovely. Please go ahead with the question.
I'm Suri Bhargav. My question is, what are the things we need to consider while giving a presentation to the clients who are going to accept our project?
We have a very eminent professor from our institute who would be taking up this question in the next session. That is from 4 o'clock to 5:30, right? So from 4 o'clock to 5:30. So I shall leave this question to him. Please come back then. If we have anything else pertaining to understanding of communication.
Ma'am, in the morning we have missed, we can't get the connection. So I have a doubt in GD, can I ask it?
Okay, go ahead.
Ma'am, we know that one of the rule of the group discussion is one should not interrupt a person who is speaking. If a person interrupts us, how we need to face the situation and how we need to tackle the situation so that we can continue our talk?
You know, for a GD in a selection process, it is very important that we have to make our presence felt. So if you are talking and someone interrupts it and it happens twice, okay, you could also raise your voice and say a little bit. I don't want you to shout at the top of your voice. You could just raise your voice and you could just make a little gesture with a smile and say, ah, well, please let me finish it. Okay? Or may I please continue with my point? Depending on how the people are around you. So just let them know that you wish to complete your suggestion before anyone else interrupts you. Okay?
Thank you, ma'am.
1051. Good afternoon, dear.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon.
Ma'am, I am Tahir from Pacific Institute of Technology, Udaipur, Rajasthan. Ma'am, my question is, we have less communication skills. Tell us tips to shine into.
When we talk about communication skills for the interview purpose, there are so many things. There is body language. In amidst the body language, there is eye contact, gestures, postures, and then of course your verbal communication. We cannot excel on one without working on the other. Because if we have, you know, developed good verbal skills, if we do not match it with our body language, our kinesics, it comes across as prepared and robotic. So what we should do is first get into groups and start talking in the language which you would be interviewed. More often than not, it is English. So start getting into groups, forming groups with people, at least a couple of them, who speak good English. And then start recording the mock interview sessions. Have interview sessions, mock interview sessions, and start recording them. See how you fare in such a circumstance. So these would help you, and then you identify the areas where you need to improve. Prepare a set of answers for the questions which are normally asked in an interview. So if you have prepared a set of 12 or 15 questions, the interview, apart from the content, would move around that. if you have in your resume that you are a good player of football or lawn tennis or badminton, be prepared that you have sound knowledge of who the current world champion is. So that way, even if the communication skill suffers a little, if you have the content, perhaps there are chances that you could make through. But for sharpening your communication skills, you have to work hard, you have to get into groups, you have to mirror practice, you have to invest yourself.
Okay, ma'am. Ma'am, my next question is, which role is better, initiator or finisher in GD?
We have already answered this question. They are different roles. So initiator, if he has done, initiator is not the person who begins the group discussion. Initiator is that person who introduces group discussion in a wholesome manner. And again, leader is that person who has the knowledge and who has the leadership skills, who can handle hostility and who can see that everybody in the group participates. So both of them are important. Many a times an initiator emerges as a leader, but it is not always true that the initiator will be the leader. Okay? 1313. Hi, good afternoon. May I request all the centers to be ready with the mics? Please give me a minute. Please give me a minute. May I request all the centers to be ready with their mics? We have several questions out here. So when we come there, we will directly get into the queries. And, that way we'll be able to avoid any delay. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, ma'am. This is Gautam, course coordinator, ma'am. My students are waiting. They are eagerly waiting to ask questions, ma'am. Please. Let me give the mic to them.
Good afternoon, ma'am. Meha from KSRCT. My question is, while doing GD, I have a doubt. What are the positions we should change while we are discussing?
What are the positions we should change?
There was a video posted in weekend. Last weekend, they have been posting a video. Mm-hmm. I have a doubt. What will be the position while we are
discussing? What happens is, when we begin with a group, in a group discussion, it is a brainstorming session. So we may have a different view about the topic. So when we begin with the discussion, we may start with a different viewpoint. But as the discussion progresses, we understand that there are parameters are wider than we had expected it initially. So now we feel that what post all the brainstorming, there are other points which needs to be strengthened. So in that case, we can change the position. So many a times we feel that we had taken a position earlier. How can we change a position now? So for that particular thing, I had suggested, perhaps we had taken a macro view of the situation. Now talking about it, seeing it through a micro lens, perhaps we should explore this particular position more. Okay?
Hi, ma'am. I'm Karthik. It's great to talk with you. My question is, in workplace, there are from various cities or areas. Everyone has a different personalities. So how could we make good relationship with them? Some may be a short temper. For example, I'm a short temper person. If someone interrupts me during my talk, I get anger. So how can we make a good relationship with them?
We have discussed this question earlier, but in just a couple of sentences, I would say, as a fresher, we are there in a corporate or in a workplace to form groups. And over there, it should be the project that matters. It should be the work that matters. So we need to, rather than concentrating on personalities, what we should do is we should concentrate on purpose of our being there. Now, once we are concentrating on the purpose, we will get to know the personalities involved. And over a period of time, they would also get to know that if you are interrupted, you get angry. So how to interject, how to see that you do not get angry, how to approach that you do not get angry. At the same time, you would realize that anger doesn't pay all the time. Perhaps people will not reach out to you if you get angry all the time. So initially, I would suggest as a fresher when you join or anywhere else, it should be the work that matters and then form a team. Understand people. Form a team. And friends, participants, it's been lovely interacting with you. So once again, we have our eminent Professor Fatak, who is the backbone of this entire project. And I invite him to come and speak with you and share his wisdom with you all. Thank you very much. Thank you, Professor Fatak. Please.
Good afternoon. I was listening to some of the question answers with great interest. I am tempted to comment on the last question which was asked, which said roughly that if I'm a short-tempered person and if someone interrupts me in my work, I might lose my temper and not behave properly. Given such possibilities, how do we build groups? There are two inherent questions in this. Number one is related to my own behavior, and number two is related to group formation. I think she answered the question correctly that you have to give prominence to the work first when you are a fresher. But I would add to it that that alone is not adequate. Please note that self-control over one's anger is absolutely essential in life entirely, not just in the workplace. You have to build relationships, and you can do so only if you are perceived to be approachable by others. If it is noticed that you are a short-tempered person and lose your temper frequently, people will avoid you. Anger, jealousies, these are some of the traits which are always considered to be present in human beings and yet ought to be controlled by human beings in order to become a more pleasant, more acceptable person to the larger society. In workplace communication, these things hold greater importance because the small group of people with whom you work, you actually spend much of your time in your life, and therefore it is very, very important to set up an appropriate relationship. Learn to control yourself. Please note that losing temper or insisting on your viewpoint or behaving exactly as you please causes problems not only in workplace, even within families, amongst friends in a class. And therefore, these are human inadequacies, these are human sort of weaknesses which we need to learn to control. It is not very easy, but if you practice it properly, you will be able to control it, and you will therefore become a more pleasant and acceptable person too. Sorry for this digression, but it was a very important point that was raised and I thought I will answer it. Please note that you will have to practice such control. It will not happen automatically. If I have my intrinsic characteristic to be short-tempered, then it will not be very easy for me to control it. But control I must, and I must learn how to control it. Anyway, I originally intended to share my thoughts about one important aspect of workplace communication. In the morning, some of the students who might have attended the morning session would know, I emphasize that the need to use language correctly is of paramount importance. In workplace communication, I will indicate two important things which are associated with appropriate appreciation and the ability of other people to take your communication seriously. These two characteristics relate to, number one, how do you formulate your communication and send it? And number two, timeliness of the communication. Let me comment on the first aspect. The most common and most frequently used interpersonal communication in a workplace will be email. It's not only within your group, but between your corporate entity and other entities, emails are the most frequently used method. Now, whenever you write an email, I think I had mentioned it very briefly in my first interaction, we typically type the email and simply press return so that the email goes. We must discipline ourselves to ensure that we should read the entire email at least once, and if it's a more important email, read it twice or thrice. In this connection, I would like to mention two thumb rules which I have discovered during this long journey. Number one, whatever precautions we take, there will be mistakes made. Unless one is a genius in the art of writing, mistakes will happen. So that is the first thumb rule. The second thumb rule is, however times I read my own draft, I may miss out on some of the errors, because as a human being, I will tend to read what I intended to write and not what I have actually written or typed. What it means is, number one, I will make mistakes, and number two, it is not easy for me to find my own mistakes. What is the solution? The solution is to develop a habit of, number one, perusing whatever draft you have at least once, and if it is more important, twice, thrice or four times. Number two, you should have friends in your workplace with whom you can coordinate requesting them to look at your draft, and similarly, you look at their drafts. This is the standard way which we advise our own master students when, for example, they prepare their final year project reports or seminar reports or something. You taking it on your own to do all the corrections is good, but is not adequate. Now, before you go to the workplace, this is precisely the time when you are in the college environment, and this could very well be an important group activity. So you can form groups of students, select on a topic, for example, a topic with which you want to practice group discussion, say. What each one of you could do is write a draft or write a short paragraph on your ideas, correct it yourself first, and mail it to all others in the group. Not from the purpose alone of taking it forward in a debate point of view or in a discussion point of view for the group discussion, but also from the point of view of getting corrections. So, one task which all the members of the group would do is, when I receive three emails, for example, from three of my friends, before looking at the meaning of the content, I will look at the form of the content. And I will correct assiduously all spelling mistakes, all grammatical errors, and send it back to the whole group. Why to the whole group? Suppose I have written a paragraph, you make those corrections, you send it to me, of course, I must read it carefully and make those corrections, whatever have been suggested. But others will also benefit by noticing the type of errors that can occur and the type of corrections that have been made. It is quite possible that three or four of you all together also may not know all the correct rules of grammar and all the correct spellings. It is therefore important for each one of you individually and as a group, for the entire group, to develop some knowledge about the correct form of usage of English language. In this context, I would like to recommend a very, very old book, more than 100 years old. It is called Chicago Manual of Style. The Chicago Manual of Style, apart from giving variety of useful information like how to use punctuation marks and so on, also contains enough details on proof editing. Proof editing is an art which was used by newspaper publishers and book publishers for ages, where the handwritten script was first converted into a lithographic thing and the printout was given to the original author. The original author would mark corrections on that. That is the act called proof editing. There are proof editing symbols, proof editing methods, which are very well elaborated in that book. In fact, there must be several other books which do that. I would strongly suggest that all of you should actually understand such proof editing tasks and imbibe these symbols and start using them. So take a printout of whatever you write, use the proof editing symbols to correct those, and then retype the correction. That way, you will actually pay more attention to the errors that get spotted and errors that get corrected. Suffice it to say that if you do that, not alone, but in a group, your language communication will improve significantly. In emails, you must, of course, always be careful about writing the correct address title of the person to whom you are addressing the email and end that thing with an appropriate termination, such as with thanks and regards, yours sincerely, or whatever it is. Please note that an email communication is often considered a formal communication and is taken very frequently as a replacement or as a substitute for the formal letters. Such communication has to be written very, very carefully and with absolute attention to the details, preferably undergoing some few rounds of correction by yourself and by your friends. Well, I thought that's all I will share with you at this juncture. We are at 3:32, so we are already 2 minutes late. I would now break for the tea and we'll continue with our session after the tea break. So we'll come back at 4 o'clock. Thank you so much. Over and out. By the way, I'm sorry, not over and out. I forgot one very, very important point. First of all of you have not yet registered on the IIT Bombay X course. Second and more important, the course, the online course, has quizzes with deadlines. I was very shocked to find that only 4,000 students have attempted the first quiz of the course. Please note that the IIT rules apply for qualification. That means if you are not able to complete your quizzes in time, if you are not able to complete all the quizzes, you may miss out on the certification. I am aware that you are attending this course not primarily from the point of view of certification, because it does not carry any credits or so. But if you work so hard, it is worth your while to work for getting a certification from IIT Bombay. It is to that extent that I am suggesting that please pay attention to the deadlines of quizzes. Already they have extended the deadline for first quiz, I think by several days. Frankly, if they had asked me, I would have said no. If 4,000 people have taken the first quiz, that's it. Others can try and qualify using the remaining quizzes. But since the announcement has already been made, I will not rescind it. But please note very carefully, now and in life in general, deadlines have a value and deadlines have to be respected. Please learn to do that, because that is also an important characteristic of whatever you do in workplace. In short, workplace communication has to be finished in time that is designated. This is a workplace communication, a quiz to be finished in time. Deadline has been extended. I am sure all of you are interested in getting some kind of qualification certificate. But even if you are not, as a practice, as a good prospective professional, you must do tasks which have been assigned and which have a deadline. I would request you all again to please pay attention to the quizzes and the deadlines. All the best. Thank you so much. And sorry for taking 5 extra minutes and cutting that much time out of your tea time. Out and over this time.